Good morning, students. Today's class we will see about the physiology, that the excretory system is questions and is most commonly asked questions and answers. First is juxtaglomerular apparatus. This is a specialized organ situated near the glomerulus of each nephron. It is formed by three different structures. They are macula densa, extraglomerular mesangial cells, and juxtaglomerular cells. The function of juxtaglomerular apparatus is secretion of renin. Along with angiotensin, renin forms the renin-angiotensin system, which is a hormone that plays an important role in maintenance of blood pressure. Secretion of other substances, the extragranular cells of juxtaglomerular apparatus secretes prostaglandin. In vitro, secretion of cytokines 1L2 and TNF by the mesangial cells is observed recently. Regulation of glomerular blood flow and glomerular filtration rate. Muscular densa plays an important role in feedback mechanism which regulate the renal blood flow and glomerular filtration rate. Second is the functions of kidney. Kidney performs several vital functions beside the formation of urine. By excreting urine, kidneys plays a principal role in maintenance of internal environment. In addition, kidney perform many other functions as below. First one, role in hemostasis. The primary function of kidney is accomplished by formation of urine. Kidney not only excretory but also regulatory organs. Excretion of waste products. The main waste products are urea, uric acid, creatinine, bilirubin. Kidney also excrete harmful foreign chemical substances such as toxins, drugs, heavy metals and pesticides. Second is maintenance of water balance, maintenance of electrolyte balance, maintenance of acid-base balance. Second is hematopoietic function. Kidneys stimulate the production of erythrocytes by secreting erythropoietin. The erythropoietin is important stimulating factor for erythropoiesis. Kidney also secretes thrombopoietin, which stimulates the production of thrombocytes. Third is endocrine function. The hormones secreted by the kidney include erythropoietin, thrombopoietin, renin, 1,25-dihydroxycholecalciferol and prostaglandins. The fourth one is regulation of blood pressure. Kidney regulates arterial blood pressure by regulating volume of extracellular fluid and through renin-angiotensin mechanism. Regulation of blood calcium level by activating 1,25-dihydroxycholecalciferol into vitamin D. Vitamin D is necessary for the absorption of calcium from the intestine. The third question is glomerular filtration. Glomerular filtration is the process by which the blood that passes through glomerular capillaries is filtered through the filtration membrane. The filtration membrane is formed by three layers. They are glomerular capillary membranes, basement membrane, and visceral layer of Bowman's capsule. When the blood passes through the glomerular capillaries, the plasma is filtered into Bowman's capsule. All the substances of plasma are filtered except plasma proteins. The filtrated fluid is now called as glomerular filtrate. The glomerular filtration is called ultrafiltration because even the minute particle is filtered, but the plasma proteins are not filtered because of large molecular size. Glomerular filtration rate defined as the total quantity of filtrate formed in all nephrons of both kidneys at the given unit of time. The normal GFR is 125 ml per minute or about 180 liters per day. The pressure determining glomerular filtrations are glomerular capillary pressure, colloid osmotic pressure, and hydrostatic osmotic pressure. The factors affecting glomerular filtration rate are renal blood flow. Renal blood flow is directly proportional to the renal GFR is directly proportional to the renal blood flow. Tubular glomerular feedback is a mechanism that regulates GFR through renal tubule and macula densa. When glomerular filtrate is passing through the terminal portion of the thick ascending segment, the macula densa acts as a sensor. It detects the concentration of sodium chloride in the tubular fluid and accordingly alters the glomerular blood flow and GFR. Glomerular capillary pressure. The GFR is directly proportional to the capillary pressure. Colloidal osmotic pressure. The GFR is inversely proportional to the colloidal osmotic pressure, which is excreted by plasma proteins in glomerular capillary blood. Hydrostatic pressure in Bowman's capsule. GFR is inversely proportional to this. Constriction of afferent arteriole. The constriction of afferent arterioles reduces the blood flow to the glomerular capillaries, which in turn reduces the GFR. constriction of efferent arteriole. If it is constricted, initially GFR increases, but later decreases the GFR. Systemic arterial pressure, variation in blood pressure above 180 mm of mercury or below 60 mm of mercury affect the renal blood flow and GFR accordingly, because autoregulatory mechanism falls beyond this range. Sympathetic stimulation. Strong sympathetic stimulation causes severe constriction of blood vessels by releasing neurotransmitter substance called noradrenaline. Surface area of capillary membrane. GFR is directly proportional to the surface area of capillary membrane. Permeability of capillary membrane. GFR is directly proportional to the glomerular capillary membrane. Contraction of glomerular mesangial cells. Constriction of these cells decreases the surface area of capillaries, resulting in reduction of glomerular filtration rate, and hormonal and other factors. Factors increasing GFR include atrial neurotropic peptide, brain neurotropic peptide, CAMP, dopamine, endothelial-derived nitric oxide prostaglandin. Factors decreasing GFR are angiotensin II, endothelins, noradrenaline, platelet activating factor. The fourth question is GFR that we already discussed. The fifth question is water reabsorption by nephrons. Reabsorption of water occurs from proximal and distal convoluted tubule in the collecting duct. Proximal convoluted tubule is highly permeable to water. However, the water reabsorption is secondary to sodium reabsorption. When sodium reabsorbs from the tubule, the osmotic pressure decreases. It causes osmosis of water from tubule. This type of reabsorption of water in the proximal convoluted tubule, which is secondary to sodium reabsorption, is called as obligatory water reabsorption. Reabsorption of the water from distal convoluted tubule and collecting duct are called facilitative water reabsorption. Normally, distal convoluted tubule and collecting duct are not permeable to water, but in the presence of antidiuretic hormone, these segments become permeable to water. So, water reabsorbs from distal convoluted tubule and collecting duct. This type of water reabsorption in the presence of ADH is called as facultative water reabsorption. Sixth question is urine formation. Kidneys excrete unwanted substances, including metabolic end products and those substances which are present in excess quantities in the body through the urine. Thus, urine formation includes three processes. First is glomerular filtration. When the blood passes through the glomerular capillaries, the plasma is filtered into the Bowman's capsule. All the substances of plasma are filtered except the plasma protein. The filtered fluid is called as glomerular filtrate. The GFR defined as total amount of ultrafiltrate formed by all nephrons of both kidneys per minute. The factors affecting GFR are blood pressure in the glomerular capillaries to the extent of 60 mm of mercury, colloid osmotic pressure 32 mm of mercury, hydrostatic pressure in Bowman's capsule is 18 mm of mercury. Second is tubular reabsorption. When the GFR allows to the tubular portion of the flows to the through the tubular portion of the nephron, both quantitative and qualitative changes occur. Since the substances are taken back into the blood from glomerular filtrate, the entire process is called tubular reabsorption. That is a selective reabsorption. The tubular cells of kidneys selectively reabsorb the substance present in the glomerular filtrate. The substances which are necessary for the body, such as glucose, amino acids, vitamins, are completely reabsorbed from renal tubule, whereas unwanted substances like metabolic waste are not reabsorbed. Mechanism of reabsorption is two types, active reabsorption and passive reabsorption. Active reabsorption, it is the movement of molecules against the electrochemical gradient. The substances are sodium, potassium, phosphate, sulfate, bicarbonate, glucose, amino acid, ascorbic acid, uric acid, and ketone bodies. Passive reabsorption is this molecule move along the electrochemical gradient. The substances absorbed are chloride, urea, and water. Tubular secretion. In addition to reabsorption from renal tubules, some substances are also secreted into lumen from the peritubular capillaries to the tubular epithelial cells. It is known as tubular secretion. The main substances secreted are para-aminohypuric acid, deodorized hydroxyl acetic acid, amino derivatives, and penicillin. The seventh question is renal tubular secretion of sodium. From the glomerular filtrate, 99% of sodium is reabsorbed. 2/3 of sodium is reabsorbed in the proximal convoluted tubule, the remaining 1/3 in the other segments of uncollecting duct. Sodium reabsorption occurs in 3 stages. First, transportation of lumen of transportation from lumen of renal tubule into tubular epithelial cells. The sodium ions are transported from the lumen into the tubular cells by 2 ways. In exchange for hydrogen ion by antipode, that is sodium counterpart protein, along the other substance like glucose, amino acids by support, that is sodium co-transport protein. Second is transport from tubular cells into the interstitial fluid. Sodium is pumped outside the cells by sodium potassium pump. This pump moves 3 sodium ions from the cell into the interstitium and 2 potassium ions from the interstitium to the cells. Third, transport from the interstitial fluid to the blood. From the interstitial fluid, sodium ions enter peritubular capillaries by concentration gradient. In the distal convoluted tubule, the sodium reabsorption is stimulated by hormone aldosterone secreted by adrenal cortex. The eighth question is renal function test. The function of kidney is assessed by employing various tests which are called renal function tests. It is of three types: evaluation of renal function by examination of urine alone, evaluation of key renal function by examination of blood, evaluation of renal by examination of blood and urine. Routine specifics by examination of urine following are determined. First, specific gravity. Normally, it is between 1.010 to 1.025, but in some conditions like chronic nephritis, it decreases. Presence of normal constituents of urine in abnormal quantity. Normally, substances like water, salt and amino acids and creatinine are excreted in the urine. But if large amount is excreted, it suggests some abnormal function status of the kidney. Microscopic examination. The presence of RBCA, pus cells, epithelial cells, cast and crystals indicate renal pathology. Examination of blood, estimation of plasma proteins. Third is total protein 7.3 g% serum albumin is 4.7, serum globulin is 2.7 g% and fibrinogen is 0.3 g%. The level of plasma protein is altered during the renal disorders. The estimation of uric acid, urea and creatinine. The urea is 25 to 40 mg%, uric acid is 2.5 mg%, creatinine is 0.5 to 1.5 mg%. The blood level of this substance increase in renal failure. Estimation of blood and urine. Plasma clearance plan. About the amount of plasma is cleared of the substance in a given unit of time. It is also known as renal clearance. This determination of clearance value of a certain substance help in assessing following renal functions like glomerular filtration rate, renal plasma volume, renal blood volume. The formula to calculate clearance value is equal to C is equal to UV divided by P, where C is the clearance, U is the concentration of the substance in urine, V is the volume of urine flow and P is the concentration of substance in the blood. The measurement of glomerular filtration rate. Inulin is the substance that is completely filtered, neither reabsorbed nor secreted. Known amount of inulin is injected into the body. After some time, the concentration of inulin in the plasma and the urine excreted are estimated. For example, the concentration of inulin is 125%, the plasma concentration is 1%, the volume of urine output is 1 ml per minute. Thus, GFR is equal to UV divided by P, that is 125 into 1 divided by 1 is equal to 125 ml per minute. Second is the creatinine clearance. It is also used to measure the GFR accurately. It is easier than inulin clearance because creatinine is already present in the body fluids and the plasma concentration steady throughout the day. Measurement of renal plasma flow. To measure the renal plasma flow, substance which is filtered and secreted but not reabsorbed should be used. Such substance is para-aminohippuric acid or PAH. PAH clearance indicate amount of plasma passed through the kidney. Third one is measurement of renal blood flow. To determine the renal blood flow, value of two factors is necessary. The renal plasma flow, percentage of plasma volume in the blood. Renal plasma flow is measured by using PAH clearance. Percentage of plasma volume in the blood, it is indirectly measured by PCV. For example, PCV is 45%. The plasma volume in the blood is 100 minus 45 is equal to 55%. that is 55 ml of plasma is present in every 100 ml of blood. Renal blood flow is calculated with the values of renal plasma volume and percentage of plasma in blood using a formula given, that is renal blood flow is equal to renal plasma flow divided by percentage of plasma in the blood. Ninth question is dialysis. The term dialysis refers to diffusion of solutes from an area of higher concentration to an area of lesser concentration through the semi-permeable membrane. This forms the principle of artificial kidney or dialysis. Patient's arterial blood is passed continuously or intermittently through an artificial kidney and then back to the body through the vein. Heparin is used as an anticoagulant while passing blood through the machine. Inside artificial kidney, the blood passes through a dialyzer called hemofilter, which contains minute channels in the post between two cellophane membranes. The cellophane membranes are porous in nature. The outer surface of these membranes is bathed in the dialysing fluid called dialysate. The used dialysate in the artificial kidney is constantly replaced by fresh dialysate. Urea, creatine, phosphate and other unwanted substances from the blood pass into the dialysate by concentration gradient. The essential substance required by the body diffuse from the dialysate into the blood. Almost all substances except plasma protein are exchanged between blood and dialysate through the cellophane membrane. In addition to dialyzer, the dialysis machine has several pumps with the pressure monitors which enable easy to follow the flow of blood from patient to the machine and back to the patient. It also pumps for flow of fresh dialysate and for the drainage of used dialysate. The 10th question is glucose reabsorption by renal tubule. Glucose is completely reabsorbed in the proximal convoluted tubule. It is transported by secondary active transport, that is sodium co-transport mechanism. Glucose and sodium bind to a common protein in the luminal membrane of tubular epithelium and enter the cell. The carrier protein is called sodium-dependent glucose transporter. From the tubular cell, glucose is transported to medullary interstitium by another carrier protein called glucose transporter. The tubular maximum for glucose in adult male is equal to 375 mg per minute. Adult female is equal to 300 mg per minute. Renal threshold for glucose is 180 mg per ml in the venous blood, and the blood level reaches 180 mg per deciliter. Glucose is not reabsorbed completely and appears in the urine. The 11th question is hypothermia. The decrease in body temperature below 35 degrees Celsius is called hypothermia. It is considered as the clinical state of subnormal body temperature when the body fails to produce enough heat to maintain the normal activities. The major setback of this condition is impairment of metabolic activities of the body. When the temperature drops below 31 degrees Celsius, it becomes fatal. Elderly patients are most susceptible to hypothermia. Classification of hypothermia: mild hypothermia when body temperature falls between 35 to 33, moderate is below 33 to 31, and severe hypothermia when the body temperature falls below 31 degrees Celsius. Causes of hypothermia include exposure to cold temperature, immersion in cold water, drug abuse, hypothyroidism, hypopituitarism, lesions in the hypothalamus, hemorrhage in certain parts of the brainstem. Signs and symptoms: mild hypothermia, uncontrolled intense shivering occurs. The affected person can manage by itself, but movements become less coordinated. Chillness causes pain and discomfort. Moderate hypothermia, shivering slows down or stops, but the muscle becomes stiff. Mental confusion, apathy occurs. Respiration becomes shallow, followed by drowsiness. Pulse becomes weak and blood pressure drops. Sometimes the strange behavior develops. Severe hypothermia, the person feels very weak and exhausted with the coordination physical disability. Pulse become weak and blood pressure decreases very much, resulting into unconsciousness. Skin become chill and its color changes to bluish gray. Eyes are dilated. The person loses consciousness gradually. Breathing slows down, followed by stiffness of arms and legs. Further drop in temperature leads to death. hyperthermia, elevation of body temperature above the set point is called hyperthermia, fever or pyrexia. Fever itself is not an illness, but it is a major sign of something going wrong in the body. It is a part of body's response to disease. Fever may be beneficial to the body, and on many occasions it plays a major role in helping the body fighting disease, particularly infections. Classification of fever: low grade fever when the body temperature is between 38 to 39, moderate is between 39 to 40, high grade is above 40 to 42. Hyperpyrexia is the rise of body temperature beyond 42 degrees Celsius. Hyperpyrexia results in damage to body tissues. Further increase in temperature become life threatening. Causes of fever: it may be because of infection. Certain substance released from the bacteria parasites affect the heat regulating system in hypothalamus, resulting in production of excess heat and fever. Hyperthyroidism: increased basal metabolic rate during the hyperthyroidism cause fever. Brain lesions: when lesions involve temperature regulating centers, fever occurs. Diabetes insipidus: this condition fever occurs without any apparent cause. Signs and symptoms include headache, sweating, shivering, muscle pain, dehydration, loss of appetite, general weakness. Hyperpyrexia may result in confusion, hallucinations, irritability and convulsions. Micturition reflex: it is the reflex by which micturition occurs. It is elicited by stimulation of stretch receptors situated in the wall of urinary bladder and urethra. When about 300 to 400 ml of urine is collected in the bladder, the intravesical pressure increases. This stretches the wall of bladder, resulting in stimulation of stretch receptor and generation of sensory impulses. Once urine enters urethra, the stretch receptors in urethra are stimulated and send apparent impulse to spinal cord via pelvic nerve fibers. Now the impulse generated from spinal centers inhibit pudendal nerve, so external sphincter relaxes and micturition occurs. Once micturition reflex begins, it is self-regenerative. That means initial contraction of bladder further activates the receptors to cause still further increase in sensory impulse from the bladder and urethra. These impulses in turn can cause further increase in reflex contraction of the bladder. The cycle continues repeatedly until force of contraction of bladder reaches the maximum, urine voided out completely. Higher centers of maturation include inhibitory centers for maturation. Centers in midbrain and cerebral cortex inhibit the maturation by suppressing the spinal maturation center. Facilitatory centers for maturation: centers in pons facilitate maturation via spinal centers. Some centers in cerebral cortex also facilitate maturation. Thank you for listening.